MARC is putting forward in a grant towards receiving some money from the federal government. And I'm going to let you explain how we got to this point, and then tell us what it is that MARC's planning on accomplishing. Just make sure that that microphone is working. I might want to turn it around.
Thank you, first of all, thank you for inviting me to join you today. I appreciate the opportunity. And so, just like Commissioner Roberts asked, I'll go ahead and share a little bit about what we're doing. Hopefully, this will be an opportunity for us to just have a good conversation about how these things intersect with what you guys are trying to do out there in Miami County. I recall we had visited with you maybe 2 years or so ago when we had completed the development of a regional climate action plan. I shared that with you, and there was a really rich discussion, as I recall. And there's a lot of very practical kinds of things that we might want to undertake for a lot of reasons, whether it's about protecting public health, saving money from energy efficiency, protecting water quality, reducing flood risks, thinking about soil conservation and agricultural practices, all of which fundamentally intersect with what's at the heart of this agenda. So I'm going to walk you through what we've been doing. I guess the highlight is we finished this plan 3 years ago. And now between the bipartisan infrastructure structure law and the Inflation Reduction Act, $2 trillion of federal funding, there's opportunities to try and implement this agenda. And we've been focused largely on one particular funding opportunity of the Inflation Reduction Act called the Climate Pollution Reduction Implementation Grant. It's a mouthful, I sometimes stumble over the words. And so what I'll share with you is some of the highlights from the plan and how we got here, and then what some of the key elements are that we've been contemplating to include in that grant. And as we walk through this, if you have thoughts about other areas of focus or priority, it would be good. That would be entirely welcome. Right. So to begin, when we adopted the climate action plan, it was very clear that MARC is an organization that has no authority to tell anybody what to do. We're a group that pulls folks together to build consensus on issues of common interest and shared concern. And so this plan is one that is written to offer a flexible framework for local communities to consider and embrace in ways that match local priorities, needs, and opportunities. And so we've gone through a lot of the kinds of actions, solutions, measures, strategies that you might imagine seeing in a plan like this. And we offer to you to say, well, this part works for us and this doesn't. And that's really how we would hope that you consider it. So I mentioned to you that we're pursuing the Climate Pollution Reduction grant. EPA required us to develop a priority climate action plan that would qualify us to submit one of these grants. And so we're going to present that priority climate action plan to the MARC board as February agenda, so we can hopefully submit that to EPA by the March 1st deadline. Grant then is due on April 1st, so we've been working on these things in parallel and doing it in ways that we hope are embedded in rich community discussion about what should be in, what shouldn't be in, and in ways that also meet what EPA's prerogatives are. So as we've done this, when we wrote the plan originally, we interacted with more than 1,000 people, which I'm really proud of because it was during the pandemic, so we went to infinity of Zoom meetings. As we began working on this priority climate action plan towards the grant, we had, I'm going to say, 10 different kinds of public workshops with maybe 500 or so people. We were trying to listen closely to what folks were the interest of folks so we could reflect that. Going back to the original plan, we conducted a greenhouse gas emissions inventory. So at that time, it was 2015 data, and we found this as a lot of assumptions, of course, there's a lot, lots of things that change. And you might not be surprised to see what are the key areas where, you know, that contribute to this. It's about using energy in buildings and transportation that are the big deals. And so as we look about what opportunities to reduce emissions, our mission's really focused on those two areas. Clean energy, building energy efficiency, transportation. And there's a bunch of other stuff that we might consider about risk management, thinking about food and agriculture, thinking about ways to store carbon in the soil to reduce it from the other sorts of pressure. Reflects what the high level of inventory was. It's like 60-some% of energy. So this regional socioeconomic stress index is one that's adapted from the Centers for Disease Control. And we're trying to understand, you know, where are communities most vulnerable to the threats posed by climate change, which we principally define as flood. So again, so much of what we need to do, we want to do. So we've looked at pretty much everybody's comprehensive plans and what we're thinking about doing. And it's fair to say that we all want clean air, we all want clean water, but we need stable water supplies, we need to reduce risks of physical disasters and other sorts of measures. And so our starting point is so much of what we need to do, we want to do anyway to do this thing. I'm not going to put all of our attention on this project on action plan tomorrow or the next day, but it looks like this. We've got some 20 different measures in it, and this is why it's focused on reducing energy burden by investing in quality housing. So we help folks, especially folks who are in need, improve the health of their home and save money by making their homes more energy efficient. So priority climate action plan and our grant, so we're going to have all this using those terms interchangeably, focuses on five areas. The first one is single family, multi-family, schools, municipal or public facilities. It could be affordable housing, and thinking about how to buy up the energy efficiency of those sorts of units. And so this is the first piece. And so our PCAP, so we're thinking about, can we invest in community centers or libraries, places where folks come together, buy up the performance of those places, and in case of severe weather or power, plug in your cell phone, put medicine in the fridge, create a place where people can come together and learn more about how to advance some of the measures that we're talking about. Reducing energy burden, quality housing, energy saving in high performance public and nonprofit and commercial buildings. In this sense, we're very new. We did receive a $4.6 million grant from the Department of Energy that's focused on putting in energy efficiency investments in 25 nonprofit buildings. The idea is to save money and drop those savings to mission. So by doing that, we buy more literacy, more health, more education, whatever the case may be. And so we believe that there's opportunities there. Similarly, there's a lot of interest in school districts across the region, and some of the renewable energy solutions are of real interest. There might be an opportunity to invest in the whole balance of cooling and powered by renewable energy, which is one school can be able to make an enormous impact. So I've got a little bit out of order. This is the Johnson County Sunset Office Building as an illustration of thinking about potential to invest in public facilities. We've also, with this grant, of course, we're trying to leverage other sources of federal money. So reduce energy burdens and reduce some need. The next big category of focus is about transportation. And so we're talking about how do we green transportation for category of work included in the PCAP is about urban green. So I kind of referenced a little bit of thing about heat islands and green transportation corridors. We know that the heat plant is a tree in the southwest corner of the lot, and such as it is, and it's saving home about 25% of the energy. It's remarkable, right? So there's, I'm sure that's like, there's always a list of benefits of planting trees and saving energy is just your one. And we can think about natural areas that people in the way of thinking about, again, resilient infrastructure that's managing runoff to reduce flood risks and beautify neighborhoods at the same time. So I think we four measures. One is about tree canopy in corridors and in neighborhoods. Another is thinking about street corridors. Single most effective measure to reduce downstream flood risk, while also improving water quality and getting habitat along the way. We've been looking with Kenny and others from 22 different communities around the region on updating regional stormwater standards that we hope will allow us to do a better job of dealing with flood risk and resilience at the same time. And we're trying to figure out how we can create more partnerships with the private sector. The next category is about regenerative agriculture and food waste. Turns out as a region, we throw away about 300,000 tons of food waste a year, which is just a ridiculous number. I know it's guilty as a mess one because it's a bigger amount. We throw away a lot of stuff, and it goes to a landfill that emits methane, which is a potent greenhouse gas. And if you think about how we can compost more, how we can support different soil conservation measures that enhance the productivity of agriculture and address food security and carbon sequestration. So there's a number of measures that have been discussed in our conversation. I think that investing in some new large-scale commercial composting facilities is going to be a high priority. Given how much waste there is and there's so many wins inside of that industry. Every job you create, you might create one job by disposing 10,000 tons of waste in a landfill, that number might be 6 to 10 by compost. So it's that job creation at the same time improving the soil and the sponge, reducing flood risk, improving air and water quality, and improving the productivity of our land. So the last thing, big piece here of our proposal has to do with policy. Again, the opportunities for consideration, whether they're of interest in Miami County, I defer to you. But one of these are your interests and priorities lie. But there's opportunities to make
discuss, I guess, as a harder time. I wonder if I proposed funding measures are eminently practical, regardless of attention to a climate agenda. I'm wondering if there's a way to unpack some of these conversations in ways that maybe just need to, I think, see kind of save money, buy down risk, increase health. Because the things that we want to do anyway, whether or not they're associated with these issues or strategies or climate action. And so along with that, perhaps as a starting point of conversation, I have a goal for
Tom, thank you. I wanted to make you aware that we have at least one public official from every city in our county, and they were asked to come to help have a broad overview of what is coming down the pipe with the grant application that your team is proposing to the federal government. And one question I have is there any mandate in this for any region? Any mandated requirement that any county, city, or departments?
We don't, Mark's not in the business of mandates. So we hope that the plan itself that we laid out 3 years ago and that we're updating is one that is, can be viewed as a flexible framework that folks can embrace in ways that are appropriate for you. And second, if we are successful in implementing these funds from EPA, our intention would then be to then create opportunities regionally to roll those funds out to support local projects based on the way we typically do business at MARC. As you know, right, we bring folks together who are from across the region, and we would jointly decide on our criteria and decision processes to say how do we focus our investments in buildings and transportation and urban green in ways that match your interests, so we can distribute funds in an equitable, transparent way.
Would these be grants? And I'm just thinking we have an issue with our courthouse HVAC system. Could we apply for a grant? So if we get an energy efficient system, maybe we could get some cost share.
Mm-hmm. That's exactly the intent. So there are, I've gone through a number of different building types. We know that there's a lot of interest in local developments across the metro to do exactly that, those kinds of projects. And so what we can do is create a pool of money and then try and figure out how to help the folks to push it out in ways that use the money most effectively and get some good work done.
I guess the follow-up question is, are they going to be, you know, through, I guess, with that, with money comes maybe requirements or rules. So I guess when would we see those?
EPA's interest is in reducing emissions. And so we would, you know, we believe we've identified a slate of projects that would enable us to do that. And I'm not a contracting expert in terms of federal money, but I think they just want to see the money spent to good effect.
Would individual businesses, if they have something that fits this criteria, be able to apply for this?
Yes, but, and here's the but. EPA has established two primary criteria for pushing this money out. The first is how much energy you save in greenhouse gases produce. The second one is environmental justice. So benefits to disadvantaged communities. And so as we would entertain proposals for different kinds of projects, we would entertain them from anybody, but that would certainly be one of the top criteria that we would apply.
Is there any questions or concerns from the audience? Feel free to participate. Ask a question.
How do they fit into this plan? I know sometimes the bigger cities have
basis than larger ones. In this program, we would certainly want to ensure that we're providing benefits to communities throughout the metro. And so, your project in Paola or Ottawa, Whisper, we want to take a hard look at it and work with you to make sure that we could find projects that hit the sweet spot based on the EPA's criteria and the nature of our general discussions. Right? So the advice that I would have is, first of all, there's just luck that we can get this money. Second, if we do, then engage with us so that as we're creating these programs to roll the funds out, we're doing so in ways that are meeting your needs. It's our interest to try and help as many communities around the metro as we can. And so we know that later in Kansas City, Kansas, or wherever, they have more staff, they're bigger, but that doesn't top me the need to try and spread the benefits around as broadly as possible.
What is timeline? Do we know?
Thank you. The grant is due to EPA on April 1st, and they have told us that they would like to have decisions made by July. So if that were the case, then it takes a number of months to get a contract together, that agreement with EPA, and then we'll start to advance processes to roll these funds out. It's a 5-year grant, and so we may be able to do everything at once, but we create the infrastructure to support project development over that time frame.
So for a second, I want to do a deeper dive into this time frame. You say the EPA requires your request for support in April, and then they make their funding decision in July.
Yes, sir.
So in that time frame, by the end of July, you're going to know if you qualify, you get, or you don't.
Right.
And how much does MARC intend to ask for?
There's another slide. Please take this slide with a grain of salt, because it's not even close to having it fully digested, but it does reflect kind of relative priorities. And as we kind of fine-tune what we mean by what we're putting into one of these things, these numbers will absolutely change. I'm sorry, ask me your question again. I just got
the amount of money you have there.
I got 100. So EPA in this program has the total pot nationally is $4.5 billion. They are rolling that out in categories, and so there's tiers, honestly, 5 tiers. The biggest one is $200 to $500 million, the lowest one is $2 to $10 million. It's our intention to apply for the tier of $100 to $200 million. We didn't want to compete against New York and LA, but we feel like we're strong and can go for a significant task. So I'm going to guess we're going to go somewhere in the 190 million range. And that would enable us to have sufficient resources, to be able to make sure that there's benefits that are addressed regionally and address, to advance strategies across these 5 sectors.
So Congress has already passed the bill that this is being funded.
Yes, sir.
It's not the
Mike, you got a question?
No question. This is the world I've lived in for 20 years. And I've never met Tom personally until now. Many of the organizations and boards I'm on that have been for 20 years up in Kansas City. And this is the way I believe our town needs to go. And there is money there, and there's a lot of different people. And I've got resources, so please use me for what I can help you. Monday I was at up in Topeka, the building conference, and that was all on the environment and all the things that we could do. And there was 200 people there in our group, say 100 of them were young people, like 18 years old. I don't know what you call, how old this one girl was. She may have been 12, she was out there. Also, I've had these people down here speaking, even in some of the things that might play. And this is good old, and they take on like 800 or 900 acres out of Powell Garden. These people are available for us to have here. Stan Slaughter, right, only composts 100,000 pounds of food waste a day. and then again speak the entire fifth grade class at Sunblock. These people are available, and they have been down here, and they have been speaking, and Carrie Gillen would be up to speak. So all these people, we know all these people over 20 years of this, and I even got chosen as a U.S. delegate in 2012, the World Food Congress Council in Turin, Italy. And with me, my career, I put on these mess halls, and I went for 4 14-hour days to listen to all the world food problems, which all under there. So please use me on this, because I see the community stuff we can do with, from the building to regenerative agriculture to whatever. Anyway, that's my skill. But you're, this is my world. Are you solid?
Well, the intent today was to be an educational for our county and our city governments and any citizens to know and understand where this particular issue was going. We have in the past pick and choose what benefited us, what would work for us. And that's the, what I say, the art of MARC region. And Tom as well, and attending these meetings now for 10 years. It's never mandatory. It's always what I call an operational blessing. You can be a part of it, you can choose to sit out. It's your call. You can benefit from it, or you can go, we're not, this is not who we are. And I think in this educational piece, I hope that you agree with me. There's some of this in there that would benefit our county. You wouldn't do everything. You couldn't do everything. But there are parts that would benefit our county. And we have had, our county commission has been very, we're not really into the political climate action stuff. It's just never been us. And so, as you know, take us off. We're glad you all are doing it. But we live in a region with how many, 2 million people, that has a lot of different interests in different parts of our region. And some people expect more, and others expect less. I remember going through the Golden City here. One of the things that came very clear to the commission at that time is the stormwater out of the intermodal and how that affects our region. And a lot of folks may not be aware of it, but as a result of that, our county began to work with the state of Kansas to determine what is the stormwater requirements for Edgerton. And how does that impact Hillsdale Lake and our watershed? Because it's a vital resource for us. And I know we've had meetings in this room with the Kansas Department of Water and other people. But how do we better address it? I think it came attention to Kenny or his predecessor, Teresa's part of it. Is our stormwater requirements adequate? You know, cause us to ask questions to protect the water supply. We haven't really finalized that yet, and you said earlier you were working with some that kind of better look at that. Having sit on that MARC board for as long as I have, you can't be on the board unless you're an elected official and appointed by your jurisdiction. Period. They're all volunteers from us to go there and go through that process to learn how it happens. MARC has brought a lot of resources to bear and to help our region become better at what we do. And this is just one more opportunity. Our county needs to consider how it might benefit our cities and our communities. And what doesn't? Let somebody else do it. I think, Christine, you had a question.
I just had a question. Gene mentioned that you should spend some cost share as far as the courthouse. It's fabulous because obviously that's the most amount of money, the largest portion of it. What portion of it, this is what I didn't ask, was would be this problems that we have with flooding be? Where would that come? Urban greening? I was just trying to figure out.
Yeah. So this grant is focused on climate change. There are many federal programs that address flooding. That's not the intention of this one. And so we're planning to make the argument that we can sequester a lot of carbon in the soil and in the vegetation using green infrastructure approaches, which intersects with flood risk reduction, but it's not the focus of this whole effort. And so if we adopt these new standards, it'll help reduce flood risks, but we probably need to look at some of the other federal funding programs to get more focused on that issue.
So
Absolutely. Right. You have a plant that's growing with the roots 3 to 6 feet deep instead of sod with, you know, 2 inch deep roots, you get radically different soil water holding capacities that effectively turn the soil into a sponge. So that's one of the reasons why we talk about native landscaping. The other is it pushes a lot of carbon into the ground and holds it there. So.
Thank you.
If the city decides they want to be part of this, what would you need from us before April 1st, if anything?
We intend to ask every city that would be interested for a letter of support for this grant to demonstrate broad community interest and support for this. So that would be one. Another, if you have comments about this, this broad agenda, please share. We can incorporate your thoughts and comments into both the priority climate action plan and into the grant. And third, as we move forward, please engage with us to help figure out how we can meet. One of the things that we're trying really hard at MARC to do is to try and weave our different regional efforts together. And so if you think about transportation or hazard mitigation or watershed management or climate action, all different kinds of, and so EPA's interest on this grant is to have applicants demonstrate how they're stacking funding, right? Taking advantage of different sources that they're going to go. And so we're thinking really hard about that. And so there's a whole other conversation about not just this piece, but how it relates to some of the other stuff that happens at MARC and how we can package things up. And you're helping us to figure out how to do that better and more people.
So I want to go back to a question Gene asked, Tom, and ask the funding part and the expectations. Should MARC be successful in acquiring whatever amount of money, is it the intent of MARC to do a, like an 80-20 kind of funding concept, or is there an expectation the local government has some money in the game?
You're ahead of us. We haven't gotten there. I think, and personally, and this isn't vetted by any committee or any process, my thought is that folks should have skin in the game for projects. It would help make the money go further, and it would, and it would reflect local support and commitment to the idea. How we actually do that is we have to figure out. So what our intention would be is to bring folks together and formulate processes and criteria like match, for example, that would enable us to move forward. But EPA for this grant has no match requirement, so they're asking for us to demonstrate how we're leveraging other resources, but they aren't asking us to match $190 million with 20%, which we would never be able to do.
Point of the question that we in the past have seen higher of KDOT, you have a 90-10 and 80-20. So it's not all the funding comes for a project, the city, county has to have some skin. And I wouldn't sure. So eventually, should this become the MARC will sit down with all the right players and kind of walk through the application process like Mayor House was saying, or the expectation for a city account. I got a project I want to do, like updating our HVAC. What would the county be required?
So the extremely question around to you, what do you think would be a reasonable requirement?
I'd like to just write a check and we'll make it happen. You used an unfair word. It's called reasonable.
I'm sorry.
But in anything the county does, we research the problem, find the right expert who can tell us how to fix the problem, and then go out and design a solution, and then get prices on what that takes. So that we have a better understanding. We're making an informed, educated, logical decision that actually solves the problem instead of just throwing money at it year after.
And so in the case of your specific question, I guess my particular counsel would be to get a feasibility study done so you know with more clarity on what it is that you need and have some numbers behind that on the cost and benefit side. And that would position you better to receive funds. I would add that the question about match notwithstanding, the issue that strikes me as more important is how would the investment in a particular building then facilitate more additional investment in similar kinds of activities moving forward? So for example, if there was some amount of savings that were generated from a project like that, would you be able to create a mechanism to reinvest those in the next energy saving project? This question of global commitment to the idea could be reflected in terms of match, or it could be in the approach about how the project would be leveraged to continue to expand on the work.
But there would be a high profile public project, so
yeah. Yeah, we're actually in the process of a mechanical engineer come in and do an assessment of the historic courthouse from the HVAC website. I assume they'll be able to identify the deficiencies of it and have the analytical data both in terms of how much flow would be needed within the, either the additional energy cost to provide that or presumably with updated technologies and energy savings. And I think from that aspect, as you look at the renovate the courthouse, the electrical efficiencies that we have in the building, we could probably take those savings to help facilitate and upgrade that system that's switching from retail and e-lockers. Switch technology to the lights, walk, and going on from the space, if that's what you're looking for, I think we would be on that pathway soon.
That's exactly what we're talking about.
That's part of the purpose I had for being a deeper study in the cities, look at the public buildings that they have responsibility for, and you have some that are in relatively good shape, but you have maybe public works buildings that have never had any energy efficiency yet that's used day by day by day. And how you look at that building in the context, how do I make it more energy efficient? How do I make, and what kind of money will I save ultimately for the public, and what do I do with that money in order to make it a reinvestment? And how much can I put into it, put in reserve to help make a match for your. And having that knowledge helps the city better be better prepared in order to participate and say, I'm ready. Put in that. Until Mark actually comes up, it's just speculation. But it's also preparation. If we intend to be an applicant in the process, we need to be assessing what we have and how we better prepare ourselves for it. Because, you know, what's interesting, we hired a new a maintenance or a director of public buildings here. His ideas were so new to our organization. Wait a minute, I'm paying this much money for these light bulbs, and they cost this much. I can find an LED replacement, and in 3 months I've paid for all of them to be replaced. And that kind of mentality has helped us go, oh, yeah, I think we can save taxpayer dollars.
One more comment about match and the studies that have been done or that are underway. I think the EPA interest would be buying up the energy saving investments. It's easy to imagine in an older building there would be a variety of building upgrades that you might want to entertain. So as we're thinking about match and that, it might be that your investment is focused on things that are not EPA's priorities and that these grant funds could focus on those energy related aspects, so forming kind of a package that meets the needs.
The tenant for transportation there, the $27 million, I apologize to you, I had a plan in getting here for the space session this morning. But did you touch on, is that associated more so from like a public transit aspect of it or infrastructure?
There's a whole bunch of things that have been contemplated. We know that there's demand for EV charging facilities. Funds to support transition of fleets to more efficient fuel
we've had some discussions in the last couple of years with the turn of 23rd Street before, where we're looking at 69-169 highway. On it, it has some significant from a travel standpoint, but then also from the recreational portion of it, especially on the weekend, you get a significant amount of bike traffic.
So hopefully you find, so I'm a bicycling advocate for, you know, all these kinds of facilities. This grant is not going to be the best place to try to find funding for a bike lane. And the main reason for that is that the emissions reduction numbers are really low when compared to, say, a building under it.
I think that's a prime example of really demonstrating the diverse region that we live in. Some of these things we talked about on this particular one will be pretty effective in more of an urban area. And you get to the rural areas, and you've got maybe we have enough trees, maybe we don't. We have a lot of trees, and our people have been real good about, you know, replacing them as they die. Obviously, that's important. And some of these things won't necessarily be needed or wanted by our rural area. Would you agree to that?
Absolutely. There's nothing about this whole agenda that is one size fits all. So we have to figure out how to shape it to fit in different contexts.
Anyone from the city have any? This is your great opportunity to pick on.
We aren't transportation, I was going to get a comment. I know that Lewisburg, for example, has received a couple of planning sustainable license grants. And I think there are communities in Miami County that have as well. And those are focused on land use and transportation kinds of issues. And if you superimpose questions like heat island and building energy performance on top of that, it just is part of a broader sustainability agenda. And so I'm imagining that some of these funds, whether building not a transportation fund or whatever, could support or further enhance previously funded PSP kinds of projects.
One of the things that all of our region has issue with, Tom, is housing. You can go back to your housing part of this. So I'm surprised there hadn't been a question about that. We, all across our city, we need housing. And how do we take benefit from this, produce housing that's more affordable or less expensive to operate? Why don't you talk about that for a second?
So, first off, I'm not an expert on housing or affordable housing. I am going to offer one kind of simple idea that contributes to that conversation. That is, it costs you less to operate your home because you're using less energy, and it's more affordable. And certainly there's 100 other aspects that need to be considered there, and I'm just not smart enough on the issues. But the idea that there's an intersection between affordability and energy conservation strikes me as a no-brainer. And so we want to explore that set of concepts. There is an affordable housing initiative in MARC, and for example, they just submitted a very large grant to HUD to support that, and we were trying to figure out how to weave in energy efficiency measures inside of that if on middle level into a much larger initiative.
Well, I for one appreciate Tom coming down and bringing us up to speed with what the initiative is all about.
Since I work at MARC,
in the MARC region. That said, any of the work that we're doing, we think would be helpful to folks from other parts of the state. I haven't talked to anybody. My first thought is there are so many different funding programs in the IRA and EIL that we might convert the next year then towards what some of those are, and so there might be opportunities to get resources. So for example, the Department of Energy has an energy efficiency and conservation block grant program. Some of those funds are flowing through the state, some are directly allocated to larger municipalities. For the state funds, the intention would be to fund exactly the kinds of things that we're talking about. And so that would be one, illustrative example of that.
I think they've been successful in some of those endeavors with seven counties each put into the
federal government's already spent and going to spend it somewhere.